This is lecture 17, which really is a follow-up of the previous lecture. So we're not going to cover anything fundamentally new here. We're just going to apply what we learned last lecture to two more examples. And the central idea here is, well, we want to measure the coefficient of static friction. And in our case, let's imagine this kind of scenario. We have a box and some kind of wooden board. We want to ask, well, what is the coefficient of static friction between this little box and the board underneath it? We're going to do it via two ways, just as examples, just to show the thinking and the calculations. And first, we're going to do it via finding what you might call the critical angle of the ramp, of a ramp, where we're going to incline this board until the box starts to slide. And then for our second method, we're going to imagine we're going to build a simple pulley system. And I'll show you how that might work. Those are not the only ways of doing it. There are lots of other ways you could imagine and maybe come up with. It's a fun little activity, maybe for a quiet Saturday afternoon. Come up with three more ways of measuring the coefficient of static friction. Anyway, let's do this. So, here's our first method. We're going to put the box onto the board, and we're going to slowly increase the angle of inclination. So, this is my board, here drawn from the side, right? I'm going to keep it fixed here, and I'm going to raise this bit up more and more and more. So, at 10 degrees, nothing's moving. Here, 20 degrees, still nothing's moving. And, there we go, 28.1 degrees, or whatever the value, right? That's where it starts sliding. So, we do it very slowly, so we find the exact angle where it starts to slide. So that's and then now we're going to figure out what is the coefficient of static friction. Let's call this situation here the critical angle. We add the critical angle right. Not steeper, sure, if we went to 50 degrees it would slide, right? But no, we went to just the value where it's just starting to slide. Okay, because that's the point where the static friction is broken, right? Where it's overcome, where the maximum is overcome. Let's draw a picture of exactly this situation here. We're not going to assume it is 28.1, it was just an example. We're just going to go call it theta max. We're going to work algebraically. So let's just sketch it like this. And so we're here, and we're going to assume this is the critical angle, so where it's just starting to slide. Just starting to slide. Okay. So I'm going to draw my block. I'm just going to draw a dot here. Because that's what I like to do, because I like to keep things simple. Let's draw the forces, right? There's always the weight. Right, we know what the weight is, it's mg. Of course, a normal force. We don't know what that is. I mean, you probably know just from having done similar examples. But we're not going to assume anything. And then there's static friction. And you can imagine, well, while the thing is it's not moving, like up here, static friction has, of course, to act up the hill direction, because the attempted acceleration without friction would be down the hill, right? So that's what static friction opposes. Static friction is gonna be like this. Now, so when I write static friction, of course, I'm assuming that we're not sliding quite yet. So we're just at that angle where if I increase the angle by another 0.001 degree, okay, now we're sliding, right? So we're just at that breaking point. It's still in place, but only like just, we're right at the limit, right? That's the idea here. Of course, in reality, you're probably having a hard time making that work. You're going to be either just below that or just above that. And if we're just above that, okay, now it started to slide. Can you imagine if you set it up very carefully, you can get sort of arbitrarily close to finding the critical angle, but we're just barely still not sliding. Okay. So because we're just barely still not sliding, we know the static friction is at a maximum. right? That's because we are at this special angle. Here, the static friction, well, it's going to be this way, right? It's going to be small. Here, it's going to be a bit bigger. Here, it's going to be, well, but that's the situation right here. Right, static friction is going to always change depending on what's needed to keep the block from moving. But we are now at that very limit. So that's why static friction is maximum. Because we're at the steepest angle. Now, I'm not claiming that there's a single maximum that's the same for all angles. Actually, a maximum changes because the normal force changes with the angle. Think about that. But it doesn't change the fact that right here we must be at whatever the maximum is. So F static friction is the static friction maximum, which of course is mu s times the normal force, and this is what we want to find, right? Let's make a note here. We want this. Right? What do we know? Do we know what the normal force is? Well, yes. I mean, let's be honest here. We've solved the same kind of situation before. In the last video, we had kinetic friction here. But those kind of look the same. It's really just the XY coordinate system down the hill, perpendicular to the hill, all the usual stuff you should be on top of by now. So it should come as no surprise to you that this is equal to mg cosine theta. And the angle here is, of course, the critical angle. Right? Because we're at the limit. So hopefully you're able to, you know, by now, figure out a geometry to rederive this if needed. Alright, so what's this equal to then? Well, we're just barely not moving, right? And so I can have my weight, of course, split up into my downhill component and my perpendicular component, the perpendicular component, this one here. That's what's equal to normal force. That's how I got that. But this also is equal to mg sine theta crit, because they cancel out. Because static, let me write FSF, and the downhill component of gravity, they cancel exactly. Otherwise we'd be moving, right? But we're still at the limit, we're just not moving. So I've got that mu s times mg cosine theta crit is equal to mg sine theta crit. Alright. So then I remember to squeeze the rest into here. A bit lazy of me, but let's do it. Of course you have more space on your page in the notebook. So I'm gonna go and say mu s times mg cosine theta crit, right? This thing here, it's equal to the downhill component of the gravity, right? This is pulling up as much as this one's pulling down. Because we know we're just a limit, we're just not moving. Mg sine theta crit. So this is going to be true. So what is true at all angles, even whether they're the critical angle or not, is that the force of static friction is equal to the downhill component of the gravity of whatever the angle is, not that critical angle where we're about to slide. That's always true for any of those pictures up there. But what's only true on the last one, where we're at this about to slide moment, is that this is also equal to this, because only at that last moment are we at a maximum. Right, so the fact that I can put this here on the left-hand side, that is because we're at that critical angle. That's why these angles are not any old angle. Those are the critical angle that we're measuring. Now you can tell that this actually simplifies rather nicely, because I can cancel out the m's and the g's. What does it tell us? Ooh, it tells us two things, interestingly. It tells us that the answer does not depend on the mass. That's kind of reassuring because we were saying coefficient of static friction only depends on the materials, right? So it shouldn't depend on the mass of the block. Indeed, it doesn't. The mass cancels out. It also doesn't depend on G. So it doesn't depend on the planet we're on. Again, that's something we anticipated. We stated, hey, mu s does not depend on the planet you're on. Well, we didn't say that, but we only said it depends on those other things. And the planet was not listed. So it's reassuring to see that, right? But so the math, the algebra here tells us a physical story. Even though we haven't finished solving it yet, the fact that we cancelled M says, hey, the mass doesn't matter. The fact we cancel out G says, hey, the planet or the gravitational field strength essentially doesn't matter. Of course, then I've got mu s times cosine theta crit is equal to sine theta crit. So I can just simplify this straightforwardly. Sine over cosine, it is of course tan. What am I doing? Tan theta crit. Yeah. Alright, that's going to be my final answer. And then, if this were if you were in the classroom right now, what we do it, we'd actually set this up and actually get a measurement for this. Maybe we do it not by measuring the angle directly, but by measuring maybe the height and the length or something like that in practice, right? You might do something like that to find the angle. But we get a value and we could plug that in here. And then when we've done our second way, we compare the two, right? Like experimentalists, we have more than one way of measuring something. Well, we'll do it and we compare to see if the two values match or how well they match. Of course, remembering there's always going to be some measurement error. Okay, that was the first way, fairly straightforward. Let's go to the second way. So here's our second setup. Again, that's something that we might actually set up in the classroom or the lab. And we take our readings, we figure out what the coefficient of friction is, and we compare it experimentally to our first value from the first method. Now, we'll just do it on the page, just work through how it would look. So here's my box, right? And it's sitting on that wooden board. It's all horizontal right now, on a table. Right, the board's here, the box is here. I'm going to imagine I'm going to attach some kind of string to it. Maybe we'll have a little hook there. String. And I run the string over a pulley that I've clamped to the edge of the table. String goes straight down. And I've got some masses, some weights that I'm hanging here. And I can imagine it stack on more and more and more. And so while this is light, it'll just hang there and not move, right? It pulls down on the string. String pulls the box over. But it's not going anywhere. Because there's friction between this one, it stops the sliding. But eventually, if I hang more and more masses here, you can imagine the whole thing is going to accelerate and start moving. So I want to add masses very slowly, like 1 gram at a time if I can do that. Maybe 10 grams at a time, whatever I can actually do. Until the box is just moving. So again, I find that critical point. Right? If it just moves, so that means we found a point, or that's the point. Where static friction just hits the maximum. Right? So in a sense, I want to find the largest possible mass I can hang from it without the sliding. And 1 more gram, oops, okay, now it's going. Right, that's kind of the idea here. So let's say we are at that stage. So this is some mass. Let's say it has mass little m. And that's what we called it before, so let's stick with it. Let's say this one has mass big M. I'm not saying this one is a bigger mass than this. It's likely not. I'm just giving it a different name. Okay, so how do I analyze this? Well, I'll do what I always do with forces. I draw a free body diagram, and I figure out, well, what are the forces acting on each one? So I've got two boxes, right? And I'm going to have to consider both of them. Let's start with this one here. So this one has a weight, and the weight is mg. Because that's what it is. The Earth does not care what you do to your setup. There is going to be a normal force. Because it's sitting on a table. And we kind of anticipate that those are going to be the same. That assumes there are no other forces going going up or down. Well, what other forces do we have? There's the string pulling, right? That is what would cause the whole thing to move, and the string pulling is to the right. That is, of course, the tension force. Call it T, give it a name. Now, if there's no friction, if that were it, then you can tell, okay, this is equal to this, but who cares? Tension is pulling the whole thing to the right. So it's going to be acceleration to the right. And that would mean this one's going to go down. Now, we are at a stage where there is friction. And indeed, the friction stops the motion from occurring because we're just at a limit, right? Where it's still on the table, still not moving. So it must be equal to the tension. Because this is left, right, this one's up, down, so they don't, like this one has to cancel this one has to cancel this, because none of them are at any angle, but they have components in the other direction. You see how I can write this? So this is squeezed in here, this is static friction. FSF. Okay, now, if I try to solve this, right, what would I say? I would say static friction is equal to tension, and static friction is mu s times n. Now, the problem is, if you try doing that, you're going to end up not knowing what a tension is. Actually, let's do it. Why not do it? So we're looking at the box right now. Right, and we have in the horizontal direction, I could call it x and y, I'm just going to call it horizontal. The horizontal direction, I have that the tension is equal to the force of static friction, right? That's because I'm just at a point where we're not moving. We've hung the maximum possible mass there before motion occurs. One more gram, ooh, it's going to go, but we haven't put that last gram on there, right? So we are still at rest. And then actually we know that the static friction has to be equal to mu s times the normal force, because we're at the breaking point. That's why this equality holds. Right, if I pull on the string with 1 newton, static friction is 1 newton. It's not moving. If you pull it 2 newtons, static friction is 2 newtons, right? It adapts. But when I reach the absolute maximum, well, whatever it is, you know, 30 newtons, well, then that 30 newtons is equal to this here because I know I'm at the maximum. So again, this equation, this equality doesn't always hold. It only holds when you know for sure your friction, your static friction, is as big as it can possibly be. Right, so these are equal because no acceleration. So they must cancel out, no acceleration. And what else does the box give us? Well, the box, if I look at the box, I can analyze the forces in the vertical direction. That, why might that be useful? Well, I know I'm probably going to need the normal force. And they have the normal force, Fn. Is equal to mg, right? Often the case, not always, but in this case, it's that easy one. So I can put those pieces together, like this one and this one, because I should have spelled this out, set it in words, but it's in the vertical direction. So I can put the pieces together. I'm going to get that, when I plug everything in, that the tension is equal to the coefficient of static friction. Now I'm going to plug in for the normal force mg. I'm not sure the color coding is still worth it at that point. Right? And we're re-plugging in the normal force, which is the same as mg in this particular situation. Now, I want to solve for this, but I don't know t, right? So I might say, okay, so I've solved it, right? At this, the value I want, the coefficient of static friction, is going to be t divided by mg. But oh dear, right? The mass you might be able to measure. In fact, in this situation, we'll have to, if you measure the mass, to be able to solve it. But the tension, I can't see what the tension in the string is. What if I hold it? Well, then I'm changing the tension. Right? Maybe you could imagine you add a sort of spring scale, like a spring in, like a string hooks to a spring, hooks to a string, and you can measure like how much the string stretches. That'd be another way of figuring out, doing a kind of measuring, figuring out the tension. But we have something else to work with. We have the other box. What do we know about the hanging weight? Well, what forces are acting there? Well, certainly it has a weight, otherwise it would be pulling in the first place. And that weight is big M times G, because we called its mass big M, and it is, the weight is the mass of the thing times G. And then what's holding it up? A normal force? No. It's not resting on anything. There's no normal force. It's hanging from a string. So there's tension. Now, you might ask, is this tension the same as this tension? And the answer is sort of yes and no. The answer is they are going to be extraordinarily similar, assuming the string is light, so it's, you know, a thin piece of string, not some heavy chain, say. And the pulley doesn't have friction and doesn't have a big mass in itself. It needs to start spinning, right? That'd be a more complicated problem that you might solve in a follow-up course. So we're going to assume the string is light and the pulley is light and there's no friction in the pulley, like in the spinning of the pulley. So then the tensions are going to be equal. Bit of an assumption there, but we can get extremely close to this ideal with the right equipment. So the hanging weight. Well, because the hanging weight is not moving and it's only vertical, because in the hanging weight there are no forces horizontally, I know that the tension is equal to its weight. Its weight is mg, and big mg. And so now I can plug this into here. So this together with this means that mu s is going to be equal to mg over little mg, which is big M. A little m. Isn't that cute? Like, that is a fun little expression that we get to in the end. Okay. So, that's our answer. Now, what we do, of course, as I said before, is we measure those, so we'll need to measure those. Now, first way, we didn't actually have to know the mass of the box. Here we have to measure those two. I mean, this one we're measuring anyway. That was the whole point, right? When is it starting to move? But we have to know the mass of the box in this one too. Hopefully it makes sense to you. If you imagine you put a really heavy box there. 10 tons. Well, you're probably not going to get it to go with the same mass if this was 10 grams, right? It makes intuitive sense, I hope. But it's the ratio of those masses that's constant. Right, the ratio of the two masses. So it's one. If this is 0.5, then it would be saying like I need to hang point. This is half of that, right? 0.5. This mass is 0.5 times this mass. If the coefficient of static friction is 0.5, this mass is 0.2 times this mass. So you know, if this is 1 kilogram, it would be 200 grams. If the coefficient of friction is 0.2, it's a rather neat expression. And then we could go measure it, compare it to the value we found from the first one, and see how close we got. There's always some measurement error, like how precisely can I determine the mass, how precisely can I determine the angle. Having done this in the classroom live, not knowing what's going to happen, we've gotten extremely close, within about 1 or 2% error. So the very values are very close to each other. It works remarkably well, even though there are no perfect pulleys, no perfectly light strings. You can get extremely close with those simple methods. Now, as I said before, if you've got a bit of time, maybe think of a third or a fourth way of figuring out what the coefficient of static friction would be between the block and board. You know, you can imagine you've got other sort of lab equipment at hand, maybe rulers and the springs, anything like that. You know, whatever you can come up with, just think about other ways of doing it. Physics is a creative process, so get your creative brain cells into gear. So hopefully that helped, just to do some more applications of friction, just to think about those concepts a bit more. So you're ready to solve a whole lot of problems now. Go ahead, do that. I'll see you in the next lecture.